Okay. People keep asking me what you use these little bitty computers for. Well, I've got a project here I'm going to document, and I'll just show you as we go along. This is a bunch of parts and pieces I got from a company called Robot Mesh. Already soldered a couple of parts on it here. This little teensy bitsy clock crystal. That's a wristwatch clock crystal. It's in there for a timer. And I've soldered on the battery for a battery case for a 2032 battery. When this is all put together, there'll be a bunch of lights and things on it, and there'll be a PICAXE computer there where it says IC1. That's the whole computer, the microcontroller, I call it a computer. I mean, that's what it is, basically. And it can access all of those neat lights. And then I put a program in there, a basic program to start with, and then you can modify it to do what you want, like put alarms on it or whatever. And it'll display the time and the day, the month, the hours, and the minutes in binary, which is kind of neat, because computer guys like binary. Actually, that's what computers work in. That's their number system. And much better to try to talk to them in binary than it is in powers of two, octal or hexadecimal or like that. So what we're going to do is we're going to build this thing. Then we're going to put the computer in. We're going to program it. We'll put a socket in the computer. So if we want to, we can take it out and use it for something else. Okay. So that's the project. That's what's going on here. You can find the company on the internet if you look around. It's called Robot Mesh. R-O-B-O-T-M-E-S-H. They're into robotics, and they have lots of parts and pieces and stuff for it to build robots with. Program these PICAXE micros, which is still another kind of micro. Okay, so there you have it. And away we go. Okay, we're moving right along. Putting this thing together, the coin cell battery mounts on it, a little watch crystal, and a small phono plug, 7805 regulator. That's on the back side, and on the front side we got four of the resistors mounted so far. I just thought I'd make a couple comments. This isn't exactly a beginner's deal to solder this together, but I guess with a little patience, take your time, you can do it. Anybody can do it. A few notes on my setup here. I use this really neat old Weller iron. Got a voltage converter power supply down here and a real nice iron up here. Just about everything. It's got a pretty pointy tip on it, if you can see that. In the old days when I did tube type circuits and some of the older electronic equipment, heat kits and that kind of thing, I had a huge soldering iron because they were bigger connection points and you had a lot more room. Here you've got some, you can see some pretty tiny spaces to get into to solder. Like the two there for that watch crystal. They're pretty close together. And you got to be really careful. I also use this this pretty neat magnifying glass light to work on. See if we can see it through there. Partially because my eyes are not that good anymore. But also it makes it much easier to see what I'm doing. It's probably 2x magnification, something like that. Somewhere in there. And I got a couple other tricks here. I have a couple other tricks here that I use when soldering. I use this as a little alligator clip as a heat sink. Means when I'm soldering a piece on there, I can clip the heat sink to it and it'll help take the heat away. So they don't ruin the part. Another thing it works good for is, particularly around the edges, is holding the part on there while you solder it. You'll notice that these parts on the bottom are couple of them are surface mounted. That means that there's no hole. They just fit up against the solder pads and then you solder them that way. Surface mount, they call that. So I use that little alligator clip to hold them in place when I can, where I can reach it. I've got this little thing here called a third hand. I use that on a live circuit board being held by the third hand. Sorry about that glare. Not much I can do about that. And then just to show you, there's the alligator clip holding that 7805 regulator in place. It's not really holding it there. I've already got it soldered in, but it's the illustration of how it gets used. All right, a couple other little tools here. Once you do put in components that have leads that go through the hole and you solder, and then you use this clippers to clip off the excess leads. And long nose, little teeny long nose pliers here that you use to bend leads and miscellaneous other little tasks. And I use for solder, I use this for this kind of work, this very, very thin stuff I got from Radio Shack. It's 0.032 inches in diameter. It's rosin core solder, which is what you use for electronics. It's very thin. I've got another roll of it up here. This is Kester solder from Chicago, but very similar stuff. You can see it's not very thick. This is 0.031, and it's rosin core solder. Good stuff. When I'm soldering on bigger equipment with bigger lugs and things, I use a thicker solder. That's 0.062 inches diameter. Yeah, it depends on what you're doing. And of course, we have miscellaneous test equipment here. We're using just the old ohmmeter now as we make connections. We make sure we haven't bridged any of the solder pads or anything like that by checking out the resistance between the pads. Make sure there's zero resistance, there's nothing between them. Those are used mostly for testing equipment, sometimes for building when you're checking circuits before you're finished, but mostly for testing equipment, looking for something's wrong with them or something you want to change. Oscilloscope there is especially handy for that. You can actually see what the waveforms of the signals look like while you're working on them. That's really handy. Okay, well, we'll get back to work now. Oh, I'm going to also, for this filament, I'm going to use this little tripod. I know you're getting probably seasick from the way these little cameras bounce around like this, and I get talking, I forget about it. So I'm going to use that. If I want to take any pictures, I actually do it any of the soldering, I'll just put it on that little teensy-weensy tripod, and we'll use that. Oh, and a couple other pieces that we use. A couple of little vices here. They're very handy for holding the boards or the parts or whatever one you're working on. And, of course, a magnifying glass. Anybody over 40 always has a magnifying glass on their bench, I guess. Okay, we're moving right along here. Putting in these resistor packs. Put this one in right here. It fits in this little, these slots. Don't know if you can see this or not, but you will when I move it down there. I stick them in there like that. And I take our handy dandy little clamping tool, wherever I put him. Here he is. Okay. Get my light down here. Take my clamping tool. Make sure I have him in there right. Go to the reverse side of the board. Clamp him in there like that to hold him on the pins. And we'll put him back in our third hand. Put the iron on. It's important to keep your iron well tinned. Every every time I snip it on and every time I turn it off, I wipe it. Makes the tip last a long time. It's about forever, actually. Okay. Get our solder. We'll solder a few of these pins, kind of like in welding. We used to call it tack soldering to hold it in, but tack welding. We're going to go ahead and solder in this pin. You can see it wiggling around a little. Once we get this pin soldered in, it'll be pretty solid. It isn't going to wiggle anymore. Okay, there we go. These little teeny holes, you got to be pretty steady to do this. That's why it's not a good idea to do it when you're hungover. Which, when I was younger, was kind of a problem for me. Finding a day when I wasn't hungover. But I managed. Been at this about 60 years. Accumulated all this test equipment, all this junk over all that time. Some of it's older than the hills, but as long as it still works, you won't find me complaining. There, we got three of those on there. So we can take our little baby off of there now, our little clamp. We'll do the other three. There's six pins on this resistor pack. Okay, moving right along. We're getting there, but we had a little problem. I put this resistor back in the wrong place because I was paying attention to what I was saying instead of what I was doing. It's not an uncommon thing for me to do. But I got the buttons in there now, the sockets, the other resistor backs. Had to unsolder this little turkey and take him out, and when I did that, why, he came out missing four legs. He can't walk that way. I suppose I could mess around and make solder connections to pick up what's left of him, but I just got on a computer, logged into Mouser Electronics, and I ordered a new one. Actually, I ordered 10 of them. Okay. There she is, sports fans. Take these last few leads off of here from the LEDs. We've done about all we can do till we get the part we screwed up. I guess I can blame it on you, because if I wasn't talking to you, I wouldn't have screwed it up. Well, that's not true. My mind wanders sometimes when I do this stuff. Inspect these solder joints. Make sure we have no bridges. Looking good. And there, we've got our LEDs mounted. Okay. Now all we need to do is we'll mount our ICs in here. Put the battery in it. Run power to it. Download the program to it. And we'll be ready to try her out when we get our resistor array that we had to order from Mouser.
I got the part I messed up in the mail the other day and soldered that in the clock board. And I spent all day yesterday debugging the program. The sample program they sent with it didn't really work the way they said it would, so I had to mess around with that. I'll show you that later. That took a day, but I learned a lot about the PICAXE while I was doing that. It's a completely different system than the Arduino that I was working on while I was waiting for the part to show up. So here's the basic board. All finished. On the back we got a 2032 3-volt battery in there, which is the timer backup for the real-time clock, so we'll know what time it is to display it. And we've soldered on our 9-volt connector there. And for the purposes of checking it out, I'm just using a 9-volt battery. Current draw of those LEDs is a little heavy to run by battery forever. It's not really designed for that. At least 200 milliamps is either one bank, the top two rows or the bottom two rows of LEDs is on all the time. 9 in one row, 10 in the other, so 10 of them at 20 milliamps each is 200 milliamps, which is 2/10 of an amp. That's just for the LEDs, so it'll probably draw 250, 300 milliamperes, which should run that battery down after a while. So what we're going to do is use a 9-volt wall wart with it, which we ordered. There's a onboard 7805 regulator, voltage regulator, soldered on the back that reduces the 9 volts to 5 volts, which is what the board needs. Alright, once it's finished, the first thing from the manual is we need to plug it in, check it out, and download the time and the date. And we'll do that with the PICAXE editor. So, here we go. We have it running now. I'll explain the binary scheme to you also a little later down the line. The LED on the right blinks at a 1 second, 1 hertz, 1 cycle per second rate there. That's done by the real-time clock. We have the 9-volt battery plugged in, and we have our programming cable plugged into the socket in the rear of the board, so it's ready to go. You'll notice that all the LEDs aren't lit up at one time. The day and the month, the top two rows are lit up together, and then the hours and minutes, the bottom two rows are lit up together. We do that on the I2C bus, which is a serial arrangement that lets us select one bus at a time because we don't have enough output pins to drive all the LEDs together. So we might have a couple transistors there to switch back and forth and run either one bank or the other bank. So we get dual use of our pins that way. Kind of a neat little way to do it. Alright, on to the setting the date and the time. We're starting the PICAXE editor now. The system's a lot different than the Arduino. PICAXE is coded in a really strange BASIC. A lot of stuff is predefined. It takes a while to catch on to that. That's what I did yesterday for the whole day. I guess I'm kind of glad that the sample beginning program didn't work because it forced me to get in there and start learning about this thing in more detail. When it starts, the editor starts, it goes to the last program we were playing with, and we're not going to use that. We're going to go to the PICAXE wizards, and we're going to pick up the real-time clock time setting wizard. That's this baby right here. Now when you look at it, it'll say set time from the computer clock or set the time manually. We want to set it from the computer's clock. Now it won't be exact because we're going to copy some code out here and then use that to program the PICAXE. And when we copy the code, it'll take the time as of then. Then when we download it into the PICAXE to start the clock, why, it'll, that time that it takes to do that is not accounted for. So the clock will be a little slow, but at least you get the idea. Hope you can see here in the year, month, day, it's filled in the right date and time for us. 2014, month 12, day 30, 10 o'clock, 10:15, and 31 seconds, 32 seconds. The seconds are counting there for us. We're going to program. This is going to give us the code to program. Here we select the DS1307, and it's on the AXE114, not the AXE110 data logger. And we want it to flash the LED at a 1 hertz rate, like we showed you before. Okay, so we've done that. Now if we hit the copy button, we've copied that code into the clipboard. We can close the wizard. We can go down to the end of this old program. We can select it all, and then we'll just paste over it. Control V. Okay, now we've got the program in there to set the clock. And we'll go back to home and we'll say program, and we'll program the PICAXE. It's downloading now, and it's downloading data, and it's running. And it says here in the lower corner, I don't know if you can see that, it says down in here, pass, PICAXE is programmed okay. If you don't believe that, we can fire up the terminal program here, go back to PICAXE, fire up terminal, and you can see it's typing out time set okay, time set okay, time set okay. That's nice. That's what it does in a program. I don't know if you can see it on there, but we'll close the terminal. It says that if the time is okay, print out time set okay. If it failed, it does a little check there. It says time setting failed. Well, it worked for us, so okay. Now we're done setting the time, and you can see on the PICAXE control binary clock that the clock isn't running. You know, the clock is running, but it's not being displayed. However, our LED is blinking at a rate of 1 hertz per second. Okay, so we're almost there. Make a song out of that. Almost there. Yeah, I shut the camera off while I was... This is the original program, so I went through and I made the changes again to make it run. Won't go into that in detail, but if you're interested, shoot me an email. If you're building this thing and you're having the same problem, and I'll explain it to you. Anyway, it is corrected, I think. Doing it from memory from yesterday, and you know how it is when you're an old guy. You can't always remember everything from day to day. So now we're gonna download it into the PICAXE. And to do that, I'm gonna move the camera so you can watch it download and start, hopefully. Okay, we've only got our LED flashing to tell us that the clock is going. This little chip right here is the real-time clock. And here's our CPU, the PICAXE 28A2, or 28X, I guess this one is. Okay, now we're going to hit the download button. We're going to compile the program or into tokens, I guess is how it does it. I don't know if it compiles all the way into machine code or not. Maybe it does. I'm not that familiar with it yet. But whatever it does, we're going to download it into the PICAXE. All right. Here we go. We're going to hit the program button, download it, download our program, compile it, download it into the PICAXE. And our light should start blinking like mad, and the display should take off. Here we go. It's doing the downloading. A little bar in the corner of the screen that you can't see, but it's there. Downloading data. Okay, it says pass program, and there you have it. All right, there's the clock is going, and the display is going. And now I'm gonna slow that display down by making a few program changes and explain to you how the binary part works. But that's it. We got to put her in a case yet and get the 9-volt supply, which I've ordered. I ordered about a dozen of those because I use them on a lot of projects, the wall wart, 9-volt wall warts. And then we'll be cooking with gas. All right, I've changed the program so that it just puts out the day and the month. Holds it there for 2 seconds and then does it again, so we're not flashing back and forth. Makes it a little easier to explain. Drinking coffee too as we go so I don't fall asleep on you. Note that the LEDs here on the day, each have, it's in binary, and each one has a associated decimal weight. Like the low order one is a 1. Next one is a 2. We're talking about powers of 2. Next one is a 4. Next one is an 8. Next one is 32. So to convert the day to decimal, I'm sorry, 16, we got 0, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16. 16 plus 8 is 24, plus 4 is 28, plus 2 is 30. So day 30. If we were in day 31, the next one would be lit tomorrow. It would be the 31st. So that's how you read that. It's kind of a thing programmers have to do all the time. But regular people in the real world don't have to worry about that crap. Okay, now you got the months. You'll see we got the same thing here. We got the 1, the 2 weight, 4 weight, and the 8 weight. Okay, so if we take the 8 and we add the 4 to it, we got 12. So it's month 12 or December. Okay, now let's change the program and we'll do hours and minutes. Okay, whoa there, baby. All right, now I've changed the program, so we're just displaying the hours. The hours right here on this line and the minutes. And we have the same system to decode the hours. You got the 1, 2, 4, 8. So if we do the 8, no 4, add the 2, 9, 10, it's 10 o'clock. And if we go to the minutes, we got the same thing up to 32 because we're going to have up to 59 minutes. So we got 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, and 32. Note that each one doubles as we go across. There is a power of 2. All right, if we say we got 16 right here, then we got the 8 just popped on. That gives us 24, so it's 24 minutes. 10, 24. And that's how it works. Now, you notice how easy it is to change that clock around with the program. That's the advantage over hardwired circuitry by using a PICAXE or some other microcontroller. Pretty easy to change. If you watch here, we'll take the modification out on the fly that I made in order to get it to do the hours and minutes. We'll download it again. We'll hit the program button and it's downloading. Notice it turns the displays off during the download operation. We hit a reset there automatically. Now we're back to a normal operation. We're flashing the day and the month. Let's say we want to make it pause 5 seconds between doing the switch. Okay, we can change our constant in here. We're doing a pause 2,000 milliseconds, which is 2 seconds. We'll change that to 5 on both the display hours and minutes routine and on the day and month routine. And we'll download the program again into the PICAXE. There we go. She's downloading. Everything's okay. No errors in the program. Now we have a 5 second delay between the switch. Gives you a little more time to read the day and the month. So it's individual, what you like, I guess. You can also program it, and I'll be doing that to as an alarm clock. You have to do that yourself. There's a sample for that, but that's how you learn how to do this stuff. Figure it out yourself. It's got 3 push buttons on here that are connected to different pins on the PICAXE, which I'm not using right now with this sample program. It's also got a photo cell in there, so we could make it. We could read that into an analog pin, and we could decide whether it was night or dark, and actually decrease the intensity of the LEDs. We may do that. We've got a little buzzer on there where we can buzz. So when the alarm clock hits to the pre-designated time, and you want to get up in the morning, you can start buzzing the buzzer. So it's got everything there. It only needs to be programmed. You don't have to rewire a doggone thing to give it all those different functions. That's the beauty of it. Well, I hope you enjoyed that. It was fun for me to put it together. Not a pro job, to be sure, but fun to do anyway. So, till the next time, over and out. See you later, cats. Here are a few more changes to the program, just screwing around here. Not a lot else to do this morning. It's like 0 degrees outside, so you're not going to catch this kid out there. So here's what we did. We made it switch faster. I don't know if you can see that or not. It switches immediately. There was a little pause there before, but we did a little bit of overlap there. Now it switches right away from the top bank to the bottom bank. And we programmed the photo cell, so when it gets dark at night, it'll slow down the switch rate. Right now it switches every 2 seconds, and here's a photocell right here. I'm going to hold that, put my thumb over that so that'll make it dark. Now you notice that the flashing rate is going to change to every 5 seconds. When we take our thumb off, the speed back up again. So during the day it'll go faster than at night. The theory here is that at night when you're half asleep, if you got this in your bedroom and you look over there and it's blinking 90 miles an hour, you probably are going to have to wake up more fully to be able to figure it out. But if it's going slower, you can just kind of drowse and dream your way through it and still know what time it is. That's the theory. Don't quote me on that.